world where equality is just another euphemism for mediocrity, where participation is more highly valued than achievement, where just enough to get by is the new standard of excellence. There is a small minority of people who fight back against such apathy, who struggle daily to reach new heights. These brave few are the hope for the future, the bright shining light for the next generation. They are the ones who will lead us to the places we have never dreamed of, to the undiscovered country, to reach goals only a few can even begin to imagine. Unfortunately, none of those people could be here tonight. So kick back and relax yourself for several hours of fun, friendship, fascinating conversation, and fabulous music. Although that's an alliteration and kind of a radio trick. Speaking of radio, you're listening to the most popular radio station in the history of broadcast radio, at least among stations that originate from Chris's living room. It's Curious Times. Your host is Curious Listener. Here she
is. Chris. All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Curious Times. It is Tuesday, August 23rd, and been a little bit gloomy, but, you know, just true to our Alberta nature, I looked out the window over there and the blue sky over on that side. So we get just about every darn day. Well, 320 days on average, we get the sun or the blue sky for at least some part of our day, which is life-saving, you know what I mean? It's good for my spirit to see that. It's like a little bit chillier. I got two balls up on my, I should just keep it here and just say two balls up, one ball up, whatever. Two balls up on my, what do you call them silly things? Thermometer with water in it. Thermometer with water and balls. What do you call the silly thing? Galileo thermometer. A Galileo thermometer. My Galileo thermometer is registering two balls up today, people. Two balls up. Okay. On a hot day, all balls are down. On a really cold day, all balls are up. We have two balls up today. All right. Okay. Water and balls don't usually mix. I wouldn't know. I'll just leave it at that. I would not know. And so, okay. So we have Stan, the man, the Kestrel here today. And we'll talk about animal totems and he'll do some readings and stuff like that for you guys. It's usually just a chill, fun little time with Stan. Nothing's going to get too serious here. And so I may sing, in which case Stan will drink more and the world will rejoice. What is coming up here in the next little bit at Curious Times? Tomorrow, Kathleen Moore is here. Thursday, hopefully Stop, Drop, and Think with Amy and Jen. Dorothy Holder is supposedly here on Friday. Leah Dawn is supposedly here on Saturday. I'm just keeping on saying supposedly because, you know, you never know, right? I've been batting not too good lately. Kelly from the Kara Center is here Sunday. And next Monday, we will do the sort of part two of the Akashic Records, and Lisa LaMandela will do some Akashic Record readings. And supposedly, a week from tonight, from his new location, perhaps, is Nick Fox, okay? Nick Fox. And so there you go. Yay! And now, so Stan, I met a long while back over there on the Broken Talk Radio, and he's used to run a store and all of this kind of stuff and have like some native stuff in there and all kinds of crap like that. I shouldn't say crap, did I say crap? And he enjoys the whole animal thing and nature, and he, you know, has spent more time than your average bear, pun intended, looking into animal totems and messages that animals bring us, we can have messages come to us. It doesn't have to be like our totem every time or something. You can have a messenger coming with something for us. So we'll talk a little bit about that, and then Stan will use his cards or whatever he wants to do. He also is, you know, since the last time I had him on my show, he has become a certified evidential medium as well. And so he was doing a lot of the coursework and things like this. He would make a comment here or there in the chat room, as he was progressing through that program. And so since a long time ago, that was the last time that Stan was here, he has probably like for a year and a half or something, I want to say at least, he's been like a certified evidential medium. And so haven't ever really gotten him, should have just put him on, put his feet to the fire here, and maybe he could connect with some deceased. But in any case, you can find Stan on Facebook at facebook.com/dakestrel, D-A-K-E-S-T-R-E-L. E-I-E-I-O. And here comes Stan. Hey, Stan, how's it going?
Hey, good evening, Chris. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. Good evening.
Good evening.
So, it's been a long, long while since you've been on. And so thanks for coming on. It's nice to
Yeah,
have
I've been really, really busy. I mean, you know, I, for that evidential medium thing, I've studied with Gloria up there at the sanctuary for about 3 years before I was able to get certified. So it's not something that you do just lightly,
not,
you know?
Yeah, it's not a seven-night internet.
Yeah. She won't certify anybody unless they really work with her for a while. And then it was 3 days of testing, 3 solid days of testing with strangers coming in and doing all kind of things, you know. So it was kind of different.
Yeah. Hey, Stan, do you have, you know what, like you're breaking up a little bit. I suspect it could be just because of your browser. I wonder if I could just scoot you in on my Skype call.
And oh,
make
sure.
It better sound that way. So what you should do is just click on that little picture of the headset, and that'll keep you in the chat room, but it'll kill your sound in the show in the browser. And I'll just scoot you in on my call over here, okay? Okay. And so here comes Stan. Okay, there you are.
I'm here, I think. How come it's still ringing?
I don't know. Maybe it's called. I don't know. I don't know. Skype is just crazy.
Okay.
It did it to me before.
It kept ringing after I answered. I don't know why.
I know. That happened to me on my old computer for about the last year and a half.
Wait a minute. There's a different girl's picture there.
What do you mean? What are you talking about?
There's another Chris there. It looks completely different here.
Like a person with long hair or something?
Yeah. I'm saying, who is this?
That was me about a month and a half ago.
Really? Okay. All right.
So, but that was a lot longer than that. But like, I chopped my hair.
Go on. Does it sound better? I wonder if now. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're not breaking up at all now.
That's beautiful. Beautiful. Yeah. Probably my browser.
Yeah, am I break? No, I got what you guys meant. I went back last night and to listen to the show, and when I was playing the meditation, it was just breaking up like crazy. And so, so I totally get what you guys were saying. Like, problem is when I play it, like I hear it perfectly. You know what I mean? And so I can't get the same listener experience that you guys are getting. So. Anyway, you had to impress the instructor. It wasn't just like, pay me your money and I'll certify you, like happens so often, right?
Right. It was three days of testing after, like I said, years of going up there once a week and trying different things. She just doesn't work on one thing, you know what
right.
I'm saying?
Yeah.
She works on a whole bunch of different things. One of the things I did, it actually became my favorite thing to do. The Fox sisters started of course, spiritualism way back. And if you're familiar with them.
I'm just a young guy. I'm kidding.
And I was, yeah, a couple of years ago. But back in the 1800s, I guess, whatever. But they developed this thing that they would go into like a closet or another room or something, and people would talk on the outside so they wouldn't see them or who they were reading. And Gloria had what we call the cabinet up there, which is a box that you would go in, and you would have, it was black curtains, so you wouldn't see who was on the outside. And you had to get messages on the inside that box and read the people on the outside that you couldn't see.
Right.
So that was one of my favorite things to do, because it seemed like once I got in there in the dark and you kept your eyes open when you were in there, but it was pretty well dark. And things just started coming for me really fast in there. And I always enjoy doing that. So we're building another one.
Awesome.
Yeah, we're going to build another one for the other center that I go to.
So when you was kind of, I always used to make fun, because you'd be, oh, got to go in the cabinet tonight. Mm-hmm. You know what,
yeah.
I mean? Like, oh, I get this vision of, you know, them sucking you into like a coffin or something like that.
Just like the nuns used to put me behind the piano, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Get that corner.
Yeah. So now when you're reading the person, are they able to give you yes or no? Like, are you getting to hear their voice at all, or are you just simply
what,
just doing all
do,
talking?
Yeah, I'll explain. What they do is, you might have five or six people out front, and they have a moderator. And the moderator, you give what you get. The first, you know, you can give how the person looks to you, or if you're getting any symbols or an age or whatever, you're getting a name. You're giving three or four things. And then the moderator asks the people out there to nod or to raise their hand or whatever if they're getting something. They, at that point, don't say anything, okay? But the moderator will know if one of the, or
gotcha,
more than one sometimes outside, will be getting something. And she'll tell you to continue, and she might ask you a question, you know, do you have a memory? Do you have a... any kind of object that might associate this person with the person out there, but you still don't know who
right,
you're actually reading.
Gotcha.
And as it goes on, you do, they are able to answer. You pick a person, you have this definite link, then you're able to converse back and forth a little bit.
And so,
it works pretty well.
And that's awesome. And I'm, you know, you did the hard work, and that's great. I just wonder now, because of your, you know, your interest and affinity with the animal totems and animals in general,
mm-hmm.
You know, have you worked on animal communication or trying to connect with deceased animals or?
Not deceased animals, but I do get animals that have passed over every once in a while. I've done that before. What I'm doing now is trying to combine the both. Sometimes I'll get animals and associate the animals with the person that's coming. You know, it'll not be a pet. It'll be like a wild animal that might have characteristics with the person that I'm reading.
I remember one time one of the neatest things was when you used to talk about how you could almost like... instead of shape-shifting yourself, in a sense, you could go inside the animal and see everything the way the animal sees from
right,
that perspective.
Yeah. When I was very young, I used to go sit out in the woods and do that. Say I was maybe 9, 10, 12, you know, in that age bracket, because I lived fairly close to the woods. And it was very safe for me out there, you know, not like now. But I would sit in the woods for hours, and I would envision myself being in that deer or being in that squirrel or that bird and looking at the world through their eyes. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of like shape-shifting, I guess, but I didn't know. And it was really a meditation, but I didn't know what meditation was either.
Right.
You know, I had no clue. I was just a kid. I thought, hey, everybody can go, you know. And
that's cool.
Yeah. That was interesting, because I used to go home and write down what I saw.
So then if a bird took off or an animal, so a beaver started to swim or something, would you be, like, along with them, or would they?
For the most part, as long as I could, you know, I wouldn't go far away normally. You know, I would look and see what path they were taking, or get up, a squirrel was in a tree looking down. Sometimes I would look down and see myself.
Yeah.
You know, which was kind of cool, you know, I'd see myself. But the thing that I kept noticing as time went on, you would see all the harm that humans are doing to their environment.
Right.
They would show me that. They would show me the pollution or the garbage somebody left on a trail or things like that. And it got a little depressing at times, you know, seeing what they're looking at all the time.
Right, yeah. Well, it's funny because I just saw a video today about, and this doesn't, you know, is, but it just says about, like, animals and, you know, there was a crow or a raven. It looked more like a raven to me because it was bigger, but that had gotten a couple of porcupine quills on it. Did you see that video today?
No, I didn't see that one. So I saw it. Go on. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's sitting on this fence, like, just, like, squawking and squawking and squawking and not going nowhere, and there's a horse, like, right here and blah, blah. So finally the people went over, and this crow/raven had, you know, three porcupine quills on the side of its, you know, face here. And sat there, and although it took some time, like, the woman, she was, you know, go to pet the, you know, and then, like, try to yank one, and it took a while, but she got all three out. But even though it was hurting every time, like, the crow never took off, never, you know, and would squawk, and then, like, go as, like, and like, but not really try to bite her or anything, but just, like, you know, do this, and it was really amazing, you know, how especially, like, a bird like that would have nothing to do with a human being, you know what I mean? And the crow or the raven knew that they needed the help of a person, and they found somebody that knew to help them and was willing to, you know?
Right.
So that was amazing, actually. It was really quite amazing to watch. I mean, I've seen other ones where dogs or horses or this or that, but, you know, they're more accustomed to the human touch. And so it was pretty amazing. I think, you know, ravens are pretty freaking smart to begin with, you know. And so I thought that was nice, you know.
There was just one on with a squirrel, too, that got a cup stuck on its head.
Oh, right. Yeah.
And he couldn't get it off. And then they helped him. I think the fireman did it or somebody. They put a blanket over him and caught him and pulled the cup off without getting bit.
Yeah.
I had an interesting experience way back. I was up in Maine one time traveling on vacation, and the people I was with were in one, you know how they have the tourist shops there, and they had a little park bench out there, and I went and sat on the park bench while they were in the shop. And this raven came and landed on the bench, you know, next to me on top of the bench, and he's squawking away there, and I'm talking to him like I'm talking. Next thing you know, everybody starts looking at us like we were an act or something. They must have thought that we did this all the time. And it's
yeah.
kind of funny. The other tourists were walking by, oh, look at that guy over there. He's talking to the bird. It must be his pet bird. And I never thought of the bird before. And the bird goes on for like a half hour. Sitting there
squawking away. That's funny. Another one I saw was, and you know how protective geese can be, mother geese particularly.
Oh, yeah.
And they can, like, hurt you. They can put a big, they can work it on it.
Yeah, even domestic geese.
Yeah, and here a little baby goose had, you know, some of that plastic stuff, right? Or it was a balloon or it was something like that was discarded by human, eh? And was really in trouble. And so this police officer came. There was a male and a female, and, like, it was looking like that everybody was going to be happier with the female, I mean, goose-wise. was going to be happier with the female doing this. And so, you know, she just like worked and worked and worked at it to untangle this poor little baby goose. And mm-hmm. and meanwhile, Mama was pacing over there, and you know what I mean? And but keeping a distance, and you know, it's amazing to me that, you know, because under no other circumstances would a mother goose be often, you know, giving a respectful distance to the human who was holding their baby, right? No way.
Right.
So they somehow know, you know, when they need us, I guess.
Well, sea turtles seem to get in trouble all the time. They be coming up to the surface, and I guess they get tangled up in our human waste garbage out there sometimes, and they seem to go, and I've seen some rescues where people untangle them, different things. The six packs used to come, the plastic with the plastic part where I have rings. And I don't know if they still have them anymore, but the animals would get caught in those rings, and they would run around with this plastic six pack thing hooked on their head or something.
Yep.
And it wasn't very nice. So fish or whatever, you know, turtles.
Come to me in the States, and I can't remember which one it was, because I'd surely love to give them a plug. But they actually, it costs them more to produce, but they're using some kind of biodegradable plastic mm-hmm. holder like this. You know what I mean? That will.
Right. Right.
Not cause that problem. And you know, so any company that goes to the, you know, to care about the
well, that's great.
There
should be more of that. Yeah.
Exactly right.
One of the things I'm doing now, I'll type it into the chat. There's a organization called OCEARCH, OCEARCH, I think it is. .org, and what they do is they track sharks. They tag sharks, and they just started last weekend on a new excursion type. They're off of New York, actually, off Montauk and Long Island in that area, and they're on after baby great whites. And so, as far as I know, they had three of them over the weekend that they caught, and then they tagged them, and they put these pingers on their fin, so you could follow them online if you go to that osearch.com and see where the baby sharks are going. Now, these were great whites, and they weighed 40, 50, 60 pounds, you know. They said they were, most of them were, the three of them were new. There was two males and one female that they caught recently. There might be more by now. But it's amazing because you see the other 2,500-pound ones on there, too, pinging. And right. People still go in the water, you know, but that's okay. But it's kind of neat to see where they go. So every day, and so the three that I know of, their names are Hudson, Montauk, and Hampton. Those are the three baby great white sharks that they're tracking out there right now. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I threw the hyperlink in so people can
yeah, there we go.
On it.
Yeah.
And I
yeah, it's a good site.
I threw in the link to the YouTube video, but anybody, anybody that's just listening in archives, if you just Google it, for crying out loud, Google search, you know, Raven, woman removes quills from Raven, you'll find the YouTube video. It's also on Facebook and stuff, mm-hmm. but, you know, the YouTube one will be the better one to watch. And it's just really cool to watch that. So I'm glad I got you before hockey season starts, because we won't see you again until...
Yeah, I know. That's why I'm trying to get... I actually, like I said, I go to three or four nights a week all summer long to different meditations or classes. I still go. I help out at other classes. And I just did a gallery for like 20-some people. And we're going to do an animal workshop in November at one of the places that I go. They've offered me the room there to do an animal workshop I've been to Lilydale a couple times this summer. I'm going back up again next week.
So now when you go, are you like working there or what are you doing? Like, are you?
I don't work there. I'm a little nervous about that yet up there. I can because since I got the certification from Gloria,
right.
I'm able to go to the stump or go to the Forest Temple, if anybody's familiar with Lilydale, and I could be a visiting medium.
Right.
The only people that can really pay and get read or do readings up there are the people who live there. The mediums that live there. But I go up for the fun of it, and it's funny because the last couple of times, last year I went a couple of times and I met some people from Canada each time I went. I don't know why I'm connecting with Canadian people when I go. It's fairly close to Canada, so a lot of Canadians come there.
Right.
But earlier in the year they were saying, oh, we're going back to Lilydale, why don't you come? So I did, and then a couple of weeks later the other group said, we're going back to Lilydale, why don't you come? So I said, okay, so I'm going next week with them.
Oh, good for you. That's good.
Yeah, I get to talk to the Canadians. And
that's one of the benefits of, you know, like when you had the shop, it was kind of like kept you stuck there. And it's nice to see it, to be able to roam around a little bit and you know, go and do those kind of things whenever you feel like you want to. So now tell me then, before you took this course, all your life, were you sort of,
the mediumship?
Yeah.
Well, there's, I think it goes back, a lot of this mediumship is, I think, passed down from people in our lives, like, you know, parents or whatever. And I remember my mom. My mom was in a wheelchair for years and years when I was growing up, and then even later. She used to always have these books around, dream books and this and that, you know what I'm saying? So I think she was into something. But then after my sister was away in Arizona with her family, and I was sort of watching her as she got older, checking up on her, I would be coming to her house and I'd hear her talking to people, and I'd come in and I'd say, Mom, weren't we on the phone or what? And she said, no, the man was here, or, you know, or this lady was here, and or some guy was here, or Uncle Joe was here or whatever. And of course there's no one there. And I know some of the people that she mentioned were passed over. So, I would just say, oh, Mom, the medication, you know? Watch that medication.
Did you take a double hit again, Mom?
Yeah, you know, don't be double dosing here on me, you know? I have enough problems. I get called in the middle of the night to go take it to the ER, you know?
There's Stan counting pills. And
yeah, just be careful, you know? Make sure that counting box is working right and all that. Flip the little dial. So, but, you know, but after she passed over and everything and I started doing this, I started with Leanne. Actually, Leanne Thomas gave a course way back, you know, and I took a course with her online, and it was mediumship, whatever, 101 or whatever. And it was fun and everything. And I started reading people, but it taught me how to meditate, even though I knew how to meditate from being in the woods. And meditation is the key to mediumship or any connection with spirit, I believe. The more you meditate, the more you're able to clear yourself of things that will be hindering what you want to do. And I meditate quite a bit right now.
Well, and I would think that, you know, like, because there are people that are just so, like, innately gifted that they can't, like, even get away from it. You know what I mean? And so for anybody that needs to work on it, for anyone that needs to work on it, then you're saying. But I have a feeling that there's, you know, people that are just so naturally.
I don't know. Even some of the top people I've talked to. Say meditation is the key. People up at Lilydale and people I've taken workshops from up there, like Sharon Klinger and who else? Joe Scheel. I've taken different workshops with people up there, and I'm saying names. Many of your people don't even know them, but there are residents up there, and they go around the country doing workshops and stuff too. And I try and get one every time I go up, or sometimes they visit our sanctuary here, you know, as guests, and I try and go there. Everybody says meditation, 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 you know. John Edwards mentions it all the time. One person, you know, so I think it's key. You got to block out the everyday life. You know what I'm saying? You got to clear your mind and ground yourself and get rid of all this garbage that's covering you. One of the things I always remember was when you meditated. You remember the old fashioned screen doors with the metal screens and how they used to clog up.
Yeah.
Okay, you know, you'd be out there scrubbing them and cleaning them because they were dusty and dirty. Well, meditation would clean out those screens of your everyday life, all this clutter that you have around you. I'm using my hands right now like an Italian, but you can't see me. But anyway.
I can see you.
But you know how them screens get all blocked up.
Yeah.
And when you meditate, it cleanses that screen so you're able to go through it and spirit's able to come through. So you have a better feeling, and plus you're grounded. So you cleanse and ground at the same time. You go through your chakras usually, and I just love it anymore. One thing how it does help is to calm you down. I was in the hospital about 5 years ago. I had a surgery, and minor surgery, but anyway, I was in the hospital. And one of the things that happened, I had to stay there for a couple of days, and there was a guy in another bed, and he had an alarm on his bed. Could you imagine these people? And this guy kept rolling around, so every like 15 minutes the nurses are coming in, you know, trying to get this guy to calm down, and it's okay, don't be moving around, you know, he's trying to get out of bed. And it was driving me crazy. I was pretty good, I was fine, I was ready to go home, you know, I just couldn't sleep. So I started to meditate, and I was watching the screens, my screens, and you can actually see your rates, your pulse rates and everything go down, and you could see it. Yeah, and so you know it works to calm you down, you know. So that's the thing. That's what you want to do.
Well, I remember way back there was, when I worked at the union office, and we had, a member benefit where we had an in-house psychologist, you know, for member counseling.
Mm-hmm.
And so he would come in, I don't know, once or twice a week or whenever it was, and in downtime or whatever, going into the back, having a cigarette. The guy drove me crazy, though, because I would go back there, and he'd have his glasses on, and he'd be, like, reading the phone book. I'm like, oh, my God, you know what I mean? And then I caught him a couple of times. He'd have his glasses off, and he'd be have his little thing on, and he'd be scraping dirt from around the frames. And I'm like, this guy is backed out, man, you know? But anyway... he had a little thing in the end where it was like a breathing and relaxation exercise, you know,
mm-hmm.
and where you could actually control, your heart rate and all that kind of stuff. And so, it's not all that, and that you could use that kind of a technique also to, and his was breathing. And then in addition to that, tensing each muscle, through your body, tensing and releasing, and then moving on to the next muscle group. And you could do that kind of a thing to, like, help yourself get to sleep and all that. So there's definitely a lot that can be achieved through breath control and, relaxation, breathing. Meditation follows somewhat in along those lines. People get in their mind, it's like the meditation can take on many forms. And
my meditation, actually, for my personal, when I go with the group, it's more like somebody's leading you, somebody's either one of the people is giving the meditation and leading us through, and music is playing in the background, and she's taking you through a garden or somewhere, you know, wherever you want to go. You go meet your guides and all this other stuff. Okay. When I meditate by myself and I'm up in the middle of the night meditating or something like that, when I write after the meditation, I go into meditation with intentions on getting messages from spirit. I don't really ask for a certain message or whatever most of the time, but I'll say, give me something. You know what I mean? I go in with the intention to give me something. But my meditation then, when I'm by myself, is not one of these worded led meditations. I listen to music, and it's not soulful wails or anything like that. I listen to music that changes tones, that changes beat, the drums. I was told by one of my guides way, way back that drum music brings in spirit. That it's like the call of the drum brings them in, you know? So I listen to drumming, and I listen to, I don't know if you're familiar with Hans Zimmer. Hans Zimmer's music goes up and down in variations, and if you like Gladiator or Batman, those kind of themes. I listen to long playing albums of that stuff for an hour or two. And by that time I'm done with that, spirit gives me things in my head, in my mind, in my head, and lots of times I'll write them down when I'm done. Now, it might not be word for word, you know, trying to remember everything, right, but I get the idea of it and I redo it.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'll post them as notes in Facebook. So if you ever are on there on Facebook and want to look through my notes, you can find my notes. They're in there, and there's quite a bit of them in there. There must be 40 or 50 of them that I have posted in notes.
Awesome.
Most of them come from the message meditations.
One of the best, and we still do this from time to time, Stan, here, was, and it came from you. You know, like we used to try to, just like on those shows where I had nothing happening or whatever, and we would play, you know, like, and you kind of fine-tuned the psychometry idea or whatever. Which is, and I really like that tip that you gave, which was, because we would be like, oh, okay, guess what I'm holding? And you,
oh, yeah.
And you said, mm-hmm. Well, look, just get people to write down like five descriptors of what it is. And they don't have to name what it is, but if they think they know what it is, they can also name it. But get them to just like write down or say what's the shape, what's the size, what's the color, what's it made of. And that technique has, you know, I think is pretty useful, actually, than just, you know, guess what it is or say the first thing that comes to your head. And so.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's sort of like psychometry. We do that in the classes. And right now I help people with classes. I go to them, but I'm more of a teacher's aide, I guess you call it. Yeah. But and I enjoy that. And we'll have classes, and we'll have somebody put an object in a box or something or a bag and not show everybody what it is, and then let everybody around them in a circle hold it, you know, and not necessarily that you can feel what's in there. And then as you hold it, you give something to the person sitting in the center of the circle, information about the object that they brought in. And of course, nobody's seen it. And then you go around and see how you did, you know. And some of the things were pretty great, you know. Some people are really on all the time.
Yeah. What other little things like that do you think would be helpful for people that are trying to work on their own with this stuff?
Well, that's a good one. And then the other thing is working with energy. I love to work with energy. Lots of times I'll just sit still and I'll hold my hands like you're holding a basketball, okay, uh-huh. With your fingers sort of spread out a little bit, and you're holding the basketball with two hands. And you could feel, I'm doing it right now, and I could right away feel my hands starting to tingle and pulse. And as you do that, start moving them in towards each other a little bit. And you could feel the energy in your palms, your hands, and it expands and it gets tighter and it contracts and then gets bigger as you move your hands in and out a little bit very slowly. And I do that quite often just to feel the energy. And I did it at the gallery I had. I had everybody in the audience with their hands in front of them. And then we just released it into the room, and all this energy that we created just exploded into the room, and it really felt great. That's another thing we do. And then we do a lot of one-on-one little testing where we'll try and match people up in the groups that don't know each other that well, let's say, or new to each other.
Right.
And we'll say, okay, the instructor will say, okay, give me a color, give me a month, you know, give me a location, things like that. And one of my favorites when we do that is to hold your hand out and imagine spirit putting something into your hand. Just hold your right hand out and the cup of your hand and imagine spirit putting something into your hand. Well, right now, I'm getting for you, I just say I'm working with you, I just, spirit put an apple in my hand. Okay? Now, symbols are very big. Now, this apple to me could mean, okay, Chris maybe isn't eating right. Chris might like apples. Chris is a teacher, you could say Chris could be a teacher. And you're getting all this little bits of information that you think the apple might mean to this person. So you say this. You say, okay, Chris, you're a teacher, okay? Mm-hmm. And you put in your little log book. I have a little book full of symbols, a separate book. I must have hundreds of them in there, all these symbols that I get. And once you write it down, your meaning for it, you never forget it, basically. Next time it comes into your hand, you get a bottle cap or a pencil or whatever. It means something to you. That's what you say. Now, it could mean you're a teacher, let's say. Now, Chris will say, no, I'm not a teacher. I'm not this. Well, but it means something to me. My father had an orchard.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So spirit always gives you something in your hand.
I'll tell you why you got the apple. And it could be because I'm a tea, whatever, all that kind of stuff too. But I would have been in the wee hours of the morning and because I'm always up all the way overnight and everything like this. And I just come across stuff, you know. And so if I come across something on a Facebook post somewhere, I'll go and look it up or I'll do whatever, right? And so it was in the area of nutrition and diet and stuff like this. And the exact thought, you know, I had is like, yeah, but I mean, you know, like pretty hard to do that when apples are like so expensive, even apples are so expensive, you know what I mean? And
right.
And it was apples specifically because, you know, like I think like apples are like about, last time I looked, we're like getting up to like almost $2 $2 a kg, I think. It's just so, like, it cost me a buck for a freaking apple.
Yeah,
I'm like, oh my God. And so in a day and age when a bottle of pop will cost you less than an apple, there's something wrong with this, you know?
Yeah. Well, I'm lucky. I still have a couple of orchards nearby me that I go right to the orchards and get a bag full once in a while.
Singly no apple.
Right. Well, see, yeah. So that's what happens. A lot of times the object, you ask for this object, and you could try it with anybody. You ask for spirit to put an object into your palm, and see how it relates to the person across from you, mm-hmm. or see how this object relates to your listeners.
Right.
And that's just another little test that I like to do. But then, like I said, I have another separate book that I write because I get some weird things.
Right.
You know, spirit. I had one I got a couple of weeks ago for one guy that I was working with, and it said Eskimo pie, you know, and I'm thinking, I'm not an ice cream cone or whatever, it's Eskimo pie, you know what I'm saying? So why Eskimo pie? So I tell him, you know, I said, you know, maybe somebody liked ice cream or whatever, you know. And he said, no, his wife really loved Eskimo pies. And you know, so that was kind of cool, you know.
Well, it gives you a chance to work out your own, you know, because we talk about, like, just give it. If you don't try and put your meaning to it necessarily, you know.
Right, that's what I said.
You know, that came through to me when I was just trying a little exercise for one night. I had done an EVP session, and Kathleen Moore was here, and we tried to connect with somebody for her. And then the next day I was sitting here, and I'm just like, all of a sudden I got it in my mind, like, I should just try and connect with this guy on my, you know. And so I sat here and I got my intent together and blah, blah, blah. And I was just going to just like blister, write down whatever. And I was just like writing everything down, and then balsamic vinegar. I'm like, what? Balsamic vinegar? That's ridiculous, you know? Mm-hmm. And so, but I wrote it down, and like it had a very specific meaning. And so like something like out of, I don't know, 13 things I wrote down, bullet point things, you know what I mean? Like 10 or 11 of them were very applicable specifically to that guy. And so I was all like, wow, that kind of floored me, you know what I mean? And it was, you know, it wasn't just generalized, you know, like balsamic vinegar, you know what I mean? And there was a specific story that was funny about it, because this guy, his wife had put him on a diet, and he specifically was all like, you know, he just wants his ranch or whatever. And then he made up some funny name for balsamic vinegar, you know what I mean? That mock balsamic vinegar, you know, he had to, his wife took his ranch dressing away and gave him this whatever, you know, and it was some mocking referral to balsamic vinegar. And so so that was just you know, evidence or proof to me that you just have to say it and risk
trust
being
what
wrong.
You get.
Well,
right.
And risk being wrong, you know, risk.
Well, but spirit isn't usually wrong.
Right.
I mean, they're
but
giving you that for a reason. Whether the person is able to accept it or not, sometimes they're going in there with a cloak over them, you know, that you're working with, and they're going in with the negativity, and they're just wanting to hear one thing.
Yeah.
And if you're not giving them that one thing, you know, it's kind of hard. But and what people got to realize too with the medium, and do you remember the show Tool Time with Tim DeSchoolman Taylor?
Yeah.
Okay, here's the way I get things. Okay, I don't see like entire people, or some people will get, oh, I see your grandmother standing next to you, she's 5'4" or whatever. I see the guy on the other side of the fence,
right,
working with Tim the Toolman Taylor.
Yeah,
I see the top of the hat maybe, or his glasses, or, you know,
right,
maybe the guy's nose.
So whatever prominent feature of that person, maybe that would stand out.
Right, right. Or even in a room, when I'll see an object in the room. Maybe I'll see a phone on a desk. Right. Okay, but what happens if I keep concentrating on that phone? Sometimes it'll expand. Next thing I'll see is the desk. Then I'll see the couch next to the desk, you know, or a chair with a lamp or something. I'll see pictures on the wall, or a hutch or something like that. So my room expands sometimes, and that works for me quite often. I'll start showing the room.
Yeah, the only reason I say risk being wrong is that people that are on this side of it, like trying to learn, that's usually the biggest thing that holds them back, is that
doubt
and
themselves.
They're afraid to be embarrassed, and they don't, you know, and make a fool of themselves. And so that's why I say risk being wrong and just say what you get, you know.
We say spit it out, spit it out. Whatever spirit's giving you, if they can't take it, that's okay. Mm-hmm. They're not going to take everything. You're not going to be like the lady on TV, Long Island Medium, who goes to talk to people in restaurants and they have a microphone on, You know what I mean? So they can answer her. And yeah. She said, oh, I never saw you before. Yeah. I saw your grandmother and all this stuff. Yeah, that's why they have a microphone on, right, to talk to her. You know?
I don't know the messages, you know. And
no, I'm
to,
just
you know,
saying. But
you're right. You're right.
Yeah. But you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you're right. So
you're getting bits and pieces.
Yeah.
So anybody that goes in for a reading and expects to get every little detail right.
Yeah.
That's not going to happen too often, you know what
and
I'm saying?
And don't focus on it. Like, I get irritated with people that are all about their accuracy rating and like that.
Right, I know.
You can't possibly say that to me because let's take a radio show like this, you know what I mean? You're going to give readings, you know, in the old days, we'd get through like 20 readings a night or something ridiculous, you know what I mean? You're not going to hear back from a bunch of those people and so, like, there isn't follow-up to say, holy, for them things that I said no to, like, I found out later that yes, or, like, so you can't say, you know, that you're 85% accurate, or, like, it kind of is a, it sticks in my, you know, it kind of, like, don't worry about it. Don't worry about how, you can't put a number
to
that. You can't.
And sometimes the person, even myself, sometimes you get this blindness. For example, one time there was a young girl that I was teamed up with, and she was doing me. She was reading me. So she says, I'm getting the name Lindsay.
Uh-huh.
So I start thinking, I said, oh, yeah, I got a great niece by the name of Lindsay. I don't know where she is. She's out in Oregon or someplace, you know, but I do have a great niece by the name of Lindsay. That's pretty good, you know, and all this stuff. And then the girl said, well, she was a nurse and all this stuff. And I'm thinking, No, she's not a nurse. She's a young teenager or maybe 20 years old. She's not a nurse. I know that, you know. And, yeah, well, that's what I was getting, you know. So it goes on for about 15 minutes, then it dawned on me. It's dawned on me. Lindsay, the girl, is named after my sister's last name.
Mm-hmm.
My sister's married name is Lindsay.
Right.
And my sister was a nurse.
Right.
So the message wasn't about the young girl.
Right.
The message was about my sister.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But I was blind to it because
sure.
My mind was concentrating on that young girl. I'm trying to figure you got the young girl. Even though I should have known all the kids' names are Lindsay. You know,
well, and sometimes, you know, that they'll take advantage, I guess, and more than one person can get a message out of one message, you know what I mean? And being efficient in this way and stuff
yeah.
like this. But the other thing that is, like, so many people have families that have so many family lies, or they don't even know their deceased relatives. They don't know a damn thing about their own genealogy, and so they're firing off all these no's, and in fact,
right.
You know, so it's challenging, you know, to say the least. But again,
right.
The best advice for anybody is to not be discouraged by that. And then there's people that just want to be, you know, I remember I had somebody came on, and I'm not going to name their name or anything like that. But, you know, they came on, and that's the beauty of IntuiTalks, right, that we can have the video on, okay? And so she came on for a reading, and there she was, you know, and this is a person that I would call for many readings back over on BT, all over the place, blah, 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 called my show so many umpteen times. And they're, like, sitting there, like, with their arms crossed like this and being combative. And this is the kind of person that anything flattering that you have to say about them, they're endorsing, yes, yes, yes. Anything, you know, that's showing them that they need to work in an area and that maybe something that's that's blocking them right now could, you know, is by their own actions. And they're in the body, like I always could imagine that was it, and I could just see it so clearly. And
sure.
they don't want to. So the person, you know, that will reject that, you know, I often sit here in my capacity as a host, and I'm all like, yeah, that one's bang on. And the person's like, nope, I don't know where you're getting that idea from. And then they start, and I just call that a win, you know. And if the person chooses to let that absorb into their consciousness or subconscious, thoughts over time and we'll pick it up later to work with it, then fine. You know what I mean? The message was given. And so, therefore, the job of the reader has been accomplished and done. What the person they're doing the reading for does with that information is entirely on them at that point. You know what
right.
I mean? So,
but do you think these big-time mediums and that go to these big galleries and stuff, they learn to read the body language of the
yeah.
people, too,
yeah.
whether they're going to be accepting to you. They can
yeah.
almost tell.
Yeah.
For one thing, I noticed going up to Lilydale to the group things that are, you know, free, that the guys sometimes are a lot harder to read because the women go to Lilydale, like it's maybe 75-80% women go there, just like you're any spiritual show, you have mostly women. But you go up to Lilydale, and then they have these people doing readings for free, you know, sometimes out at the stump or the forest. And they pick people out of the audience and say, I'm getting somebody for you, or is there anybody out there that this might associate with? And very seldom will they go to, like you say, a person sitting there with their arms folded.
Yeah, absolutely.
They're going to stay away from those people because
yeah.
they know from experience
yeah.
that those people are more negative. They're just there because their wife drug them along. You know,
yeah.
they don't want to be there. They want to be home watching the football game or the baseball game,
yeah.
and they don't want to be sitting there on that stump.
Yeah. Well, listen. So we're an hour in already. Time flies, and so let's do a song, and then let's take some calls, and then we'll see where
okay.
we're from there. Okay.
Very good.
So. We're going to go with your, we'll close the show out with one of my favorite songs is by Arvel Bird and called Animal Totems, but we'll go with your Sissel, You Raise Me Up, and here we go.
Oh, thanks.
Then I'll stay and wait till
All right. Well, you got to keep in mind that I have no way to mute anybody, and I am hearing a little bit of static on the call with Stan, and so, you know, that's okay. If it breaks up see, Heath is hardwired in, and it didn't break for him, but he heard the static, and so usually the wireless people have a little bit more of a challenge, you know, because there's just little blips in their signal, and that's what's going on.
Yeah. I muted myself when the song was playing, too. I don't know if you muted me or not, but I muted myself. So.
Oh, okay. I could hear you still. I could hear you in my ear set.
My headset was muted?
I don't know. I could hear, you know, a little bit of movement over in your place or whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, nothing too obstruct, you know, nothing bad. Mm. I could hear. And ever since I joined the call with you, I do have a bit of static, you know what I mean? It's no big deal. And so it is what it is. It's telecommunications, people. And we're, you know, that is what it is. So, okay. So we do have a few callers. Now, are you just going to do the animal stuff, or what do you...
We'll do the animals, and then if anybody comes in for them, well, I'm doing animals. So, you know, whatever we get... a couple of cards. I got a brand new deck. I never tried it yet. And I just looked at the cards today, and I blessed the deck, and I got a couple. I actually got three decks here. But this one here, who's it by? Susie Green. Never heard of her before, but I picked this deck up. And Animal Messages. Seek inspiration from your animal guides.
Perfect. Okay, we'll go and Margie had her hand up first here, and then I have Eric. I think Eric, because I see you in chat and I see you on the phone, and then I see a cell phone caller, and so that's what I know. If anybody else is wanting a reading, let me know. Oh crap. Okay, I'm just gonna bring Margie on, and I gotta go do some spider control here. Margie.
Oh, no.
Great timing for finding spiders.
I know, right?
I think I'll just pull the spider card for Chris. You know, spiders are actually very creative. And they weave that web, and they're like little artists. And most of the people that get the spider for a totem or even when I get the card for them, they're very artistic, and they might be writers, things like that. So who knows what we're going to get for you, Marge. Can you do me a favor, though? Just give me the date of the month you were born in, like today's the 23rd, whatever.
The 5th.
Oh, that's easy. I only have to shuffle five times. Okay, let's pull a couple cards. Oh, beautiful. First card you got, Marge, is the eagle. First of all, have you ever got animal readings before for me at all, anywhere?
No.
Okay. The eagle, of course, is our most spiritual totem. He's like the top of the line spiritual-wise. So he's telling me that you're a very spiritual person, and... you might be involved in the healing aspects of things or spiritual aspects of things. You might do readings yourself. If you don't, you might do very well at it. And he's also talking about creating your own vision. All the big birds, the hawks and the eagles and even the little kestrel like me, have great vision. And you can really get this vision going if you set a goal. You know, if you have something out there that you really want to see, that way the vision will be right in front of you and you can concentrate on it. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
Okay. Let me pull another one. Oh, this card. Like I said, this is a new deck. I have no idea what these animals are. This is the sloth. and the picture of this guy, it's probably a lady sloth, actually. She has a child with her, and she's swinging through the branches of the trees. It's really kind of neat. And it's telling me that children might surround you, that if they don't, you'd be very good working with children. Do they surround you? Am I right here?
Yes. Just happened tonight, in fact.
It just happened tonight. They wouldn't let go, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
They wouldn't let go. That's what this picture is telling me here, that this little sloth is hanging on to mom, and she's swinging through the branches, and he just won't let go. It's kind of fun, actually. But it seems to be a thing with hanging on to your treasured objects, too. And the little one treasures you, and which it should, and you treasure the little one with you. So that's the thing. You got to hang on to each other. There'll be times when you will just probably want to push them away, you know. But this isn't one of them times. So just remember that. You can hang on to each other and take care of one another, all right? I've never done sloths before, but that's what I got out of that card. It's not an animal that people, you know, think of too often.
And they don't brag about it.
But it's a neat, beautiful card, Chris. Yeah. And it's got the baby with it and the mom. So that's kind of cool. I'll get another one for you. Oh, this one I love. I don't even know all the animals in this deck. I did go through it. This is the wild horse, and horses to me are about sowing your wild oats or getting out there, you know. I don't know if you're getting the urge to travel, to jump over that fence and get out of the house and do something, you know, find a new job, whatever. But something new, it's like you go, especially wild horses. And this card is actually a wild horse. All horses want to go, though. But it's telling me that it might be time to you know, try something new. Jump over that fence and try something new. And don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. You're going to be going out there with no rider, you know. You're in charge. The horse is in charge, and he has the freedom to do what he wants. They're very associated with freedom and flying out there. So don't be afraid to do that, okay?
Definitely.
Okay, let's do one more for you. You got another bird of prey. Okay, this one will lead us into something. You got the owl. And owls are very spiritual, too, but they're spiritual in a different way than the eagle. The owls relate to people who have passed over. And there's a female energy coming in for you. And this owl is saying that this person probably passed not too long ago, maybe a couple of years. I'm not sure if it's a mother, grandmother, but it's on that side of the family.
Okay.
You've gone silent on me a little bit.
Oh, no, I'm just, I'm...
That's okay. That's all right. This person's very purposeful, like very strong in a way. Maybe not physically strong, but strong-minded, strong-willed. She's asking, she might be there looking out over the child, too. She's asking for compassion. I'm hearing the word compassion. I don't know if there was a problem when she passed or something, you know, that was a disagreement on something. but she's asking for compassion, and it's almost like she's not sorry she passed, because once they get on the other side, they're actually pretty okay. Believe me, they're pretty okay on that side. They're doing fine. But
right.
she might be sorry for something that she might have done to you or relates to you. Is this working for you?
Now that you said that, it makes more sense. At first, I was kind of,
okay.
You know, trying, you know, how you try really hard to try and figure it out. But once you said that, it made more sense.
Okay. Well, I'm getting somebody older, but I'm not sure if it's a mom or a grandmother. It might be even a great aunt, but it's on that side of the family. But she doesn't see, she was like standoffish a little bit. And she's there, and I'm just getting like, she wants to come in, but she's not really here. And I think she might be a little bit hesitant. Sometimes when people haven't been on the other side that long, and then we do make contact with them, they're a little bit hesitant to come through. And time means nothing to them. It's opportunity and everything. There is no sense of time on that side. So they might be 6 months, it might be 2 years, it might be 5 years. So that really doesn't matter, but it's the opportunity to talk to you. I don't think this person has had an opportunity to talk to you too much since they're passed over.
I thought she might have come through a few times, but I'm not totally sure. A couple of times that I've had a few readings.
Okay. It's like she tried, she might have tried to come through, but sometimes she's a little hesitant, a little bit backed off, you know, because there has to be a real connection and strength. And sometimes there's others that might want to jump in front of her too, and this might have happened in the past. But she's there now, and see if I can get a memory. She's talking about, did she work retail or in a store or something like that? She's talking about sales. And I don't know if it was just a shopping thing or a selling thing. She's talking to me about sales, trying to catch up with the sales. Could be a boat, too. I'm steering sales.
I'm trying to think of everything that, if it's my grandma, that she would have done.
Yeah.
Possible.
She's right there, but she's on the fringes. I'm trying to get her back. Okay. Apparently there was some letters written or something written, some kind of documents, whether it had to do with real estate or something, and there was a disagreement on it. That's what I'm getting from this lady. There was some kind of disagreement because of some letters written. Now, you might have to talk to somebody else about this or think about it a little bit.
I actually...
I know
exactly what you're talking about.
All right. Well, that's what she has, this little bit of... a little bit of a reluctance to talk about it, I guess. And,
yeah, there was some stuff that happened just before she passed, a few years before she passed away. And I'm pretty sure that's what you're talking about.
It might be, like I said, some kind of deeds, letters, real estate, something that's written on paper that everybody didn't agree with.
Yep.
And there was some squabbling, I guess you could say. And this should have been done, that should have been done, that kind of thing. Well, anyway, she just wants you to know that she's letting you know about it, and she's a little upset that it wasn't clearer. You know what I'm saying? That the whole thing wasn't done clearer. But she does care about you, and let me see if I can get a message. I'll write this down. Time for me to get my little pen here. Just give me a second.
That's okay.
What I got from her, it's a simple little message. The books are still open, so there's still opportunity maybe to change things, what I'm getting.
Hmm.
The books are still open, so just remember that, all right?
Okay.
And I'll pull one more card for you.
Thank you.
Thank her for coming in.
Yeah, thank you, Grandma.
Okay. The other animal card I got for you is the bison. And the bison is,
sorry.
And it's a wonderful card. And,
no, it's.
Vaughn, what's with the bison?
No, bison? You just. I'll. No. Sorry. No. I will tell you as soon as you get done. Sorry.
Okay. Let me finish the bison, then you can tell me. There's a connection here somehow that made you laugh. But anyway, the bison is telling me about abundance, and you know how when the Native Americans hunted the bison. The bison gave them everything they need. They used every part of the bison. And the bison knew that he was giving up his life to sustain the Native Americans. And it was like a working relationship. They took what they needed. They were fed with the buffalo meat. They had made their robes out of the buffalo meat. You know, they used the skins. Everything was used, and that was a good thing. And the bison understood this, but he provided all the abundance they needed. So what he's telling me that you're going to be provided for, that if you think about bison anytime you got bills to pay or the refrigerator might look empty today, you know, that somehow, some way, it's going to get provided for. Just think about the bison and understand that that's what's going to happen, okay? Now, what's
awesome
with the bison?
I live in North Dakota, and my husband went to North Dakota State University, and they are the bison. And now it's and it's football season. So, yeah, my whole house is... Bison.
All about
bison.
The bison.
It's all about the bison.
There's the connection. And, you know, and I pulled that extra card for you because I figured there was something missing yet that we didn't get to.
That is hilarious. I have a question.
In other words, you have an abundance of bison.
Exactly. Now I just need the other abundance. question for you. Back to the owl.
Yeah.
When a person ends up seeing an actual owl, about 6 years ago, maybe sooner, we were driving home late. I mean, it was like after midnight, and we got to a crossing, and there was this huge owl. I mean, it was gigantic, sitting literally in the middle of the road, and it was right as we were starting to already slow down because we were coming to the stop sign, and we were able to stop, and he just sat there for a second, then took off. So when a person sees something like that, is there a meaning to it?
When you see any animal or any bird or bee or wasps, anything doing something unusual. Okay? Something you don't see every day. Like you can see sparrows at your bird feeder every day, and next thing you know, there's one on your windowsill looking in your window. Anytime you see some animal doing something unusual, that's when they usually have a message for you. And any animal can give you a message any time of day. You know, you might see one on TV or whatever. So that owl probably did have a message for you. And it probably was from somebody who's passed over, because owls are connectors with, people who have passed.
Right.
Our relatives, it's usually relatives and that want to contact us about something. So just if it happens again, you know, which it might, just remember that and think that the animal does have that message for you, and somebody wants to contact you, especially
okay.
the owls.
Because that was the first, I mean, you know, we've all seen different birds at the zoos and stuff, but this was the
mm-hmm.
first time I'd ever seen anything like that. So it's always stuck in my mind. And then when you got the owl card, I was kind of, you know, that brought that back to me. So that I was just
right.
Curious.
It was a memory. It was a memory.
Yeah.
And it came up for a reason too. Maybe, but the owl was connecting probably with your grandmother too at this
mm-hmm.
time. You might have had another relative or her if she had passed before or after. I don't know.
And
but,
she was after, yeah.
Yeah, it was after. So, but that relative who had passed earlier probably had a message for you.
Okay, and it was at that time I didn't
open.
Realize it.
You got to be open. You got to be open to it. That's the thing. Anytime you see an animal doing something unusual, just ask. You know, talk to the animal. Say, what do you want? What's going on? You know, and usually you get this thought in your mind right away. You know, it's not going to be the animal. It's not going to sit there and squawk for you, but you'll get a thought. It's a mental message.
Okay. Cool.
Great.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you, Ms. Gress.
Thank you.
Okay. So listen, you got a half an hour, and by my count, 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 people. So.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
That's okay. So I'm going to go, Eric, if you are in queue, Eric, press your 1 button on your phone now, okay? Yep.
Hello.
Hey, Eric. How's it going?
Hi, Eric. I'll try and be a little quicker. I'm sorry.
Hi, Stan.
Hi. How are you doing? Okay, I just
doing
need a
okay.
date from your month. I'm sorry?
The 15th.
15th. Okay, great. Watch, I'll get all 29s.
I know, right? I was thinking that. Give us a number.
Okay. We'll pull a couple here. That happens to me all the time. I can go on forever, though. Okay. We got the red squirrel for you in this deck, and I've had other decks with gray squirrels in, but this one's a red one. And he's talking about, of course, you know, how squirrels save for future. They put their nuts back in the tree sometimes and things like that. But he's saying to conserve your resources, that sometimes you might go on a spending spree to just watch what you're doing right now. Don't overdo it. Don't be like my son. My son comes home from me today, and guess what he tells me? He says, guess what I did today? I said, what? I flew in a B-25. I said, what do you mean you flew in a B-25? He stopped at the local airport, paid $450 for a half-hour flight in a B-25. He says, you know, I don't do too much for myself. But anyway, don't be like him, Eric. He had a great time, though. He said he loved it. But the
okay.
Red Squirrel wants you to that. He wants you to conserve a little bit. Just be careful right now. Things might be a little tight. You know, just watch what you're doing a little bit, okay? And I'll keep going. I got another one for you. This is the orangutan in this deck. And he's very happy. And what he's telling me is you don't have to live to work. This might have a little opposite effect of what the squirrel was talking about. Some people work to live, you know, and their whole life is work, 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 work. The orangutan wants to have a little fun, especially maybe at work. So he's just saying you don't have to work constantly to get what you want. The squirrel's telling you to conserve a little bit, and orangutan might be telling you a little bit of the opposite story. Maybe there's two sides of this coin, but don't overwork either. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, and I got one more for you, the tortoise. Tortoises are all about grounding. Do you meditate, Eric?
From time to time, but I need to do it more regularly.
Right. Okay. The tortoise, of course, is grounded to Mother Earth. He's walking around, and he's grounded. And one thing you notice about a tortoise is his shell is like a mosaic. Any of the turtles, you know, but the tortoise, it's like a big mosaic puzzle. He's got all them little angles and things, and it really looks cool. But all of his pieces are put together. They're all, you know, in a space there. So just remember, if you want to be grounded, you got to get your entire shell in order, okay?
Okay.
So try and get, that's his house, you know, try and get your house in order. There might be things out of place right now, things mixing you up. So get everything in order, okay?
Okay. All right.
All right. All right. One more, and that's it. And I already talked about this little dude. We mentioned it right before Chris ran away. It's the spider. And are you artistic? Do you work in arts? Any kind of writing? Right.
I'm a software engineer, so
okay.
I enjoy art, maybe I need to do. Maybe I need to be more.
No,
artistic.
No.
I don't know.
Yeah, but it's perfect. The web, the WW, World Wide Web. There you go.
Okay.
That's why it came up for you, Eric. You're in the web.
Okay. Well, is that a good or bad thing? What does that mean exactly, other than the connection?
It means that's probably your job. You know, just like last time we got the buffalo or the bison for the last caller, this time we got this as your last card, and that you're entitled to the web. But think about writing. Usually I get that card for writers. Think about doing something writing, if you can.
All right.
Okay? All right?
Okay.
Thank
you very much.
I'll write some code that'll make you $1 million.
Yeah, you know. Oh, well, yeah, write that new game, you know, Pokemon number 3 or whatever.
Oh, my God. Poke my eye out. Okay. Thanks, Eric.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you.
All right. Talk to you later.
I've never played Pokemon, I don't think.
No. I shake my head, you know what I mean? Okay,
yep.
Who's this cell phone caller? Hello?
This is Lorraine.
Hi, Lorraine. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Not so bad, thank you.
Hi, Lorraine.
Hi. I'm sitting here with my husband listening to you, and we thought this was pretty interesting, so we thought we'd
very good. Okay, well, we'll pull a couple cards for you guys, okay?
Yes.
What's your birth date? Just a date.
Mine's the 27th.
Okay, I told you, Chris.
Yeah.
I was actually dreading telling you that.
Okay, I did it quick.
Yeah.
We're
okay.
Good. we got the kangaroo to start off with. And he's telling me that you're doing a lot of jumping around. Are you guys moving or are very active right now?
We're not moving, but I guess we're active.
Yeah, he's saying that you're active. And the other thing with the kangaroo that I'm getting is, you know, how they jump and they're doing that. But this kangaroo, I'm looking at the picture, and a lot of times I just look at the pictures and I throw away the books with this brand new deck. This kangaroo has a little kangaroo in its pouch. Is someone possibly pregnant around you?
I highly doubt it. Not that I know of. I should say that. Not that I know of. It's not me.
Okay. Well, it doesn't have to be you, but I just see the little one in the pouch. That little one is well taken care of. So there might be something new coming into your life. If you're jumping around, you might jump onto something new is what we're getting from that card, okay? Let me pull another one. This is the badger. And, the badgers are a lot tougher than what we think sometimes. They're not, huge animal like a bear or something like that. But they're very, very strong and very tough. And he's saying that you don't like to compromise all the time, and maybe you shouldn't. That things when they're on your side of the schedule, your side of the base there, that sometimes you don't want to give in. But that might be a good thing, because if you start giving in all the time, you'll never get anywhere. You won't keep your integrity. And he keeps his integrity by doing that. So just remember that, okay?
Okay, that sounded just like me.
Just like you. Yeah, you don't like to give in all the time. Okay.
Yes,
I got the deer for you. And the deer is talking about your different paths. Like we're all, this might have to do with the jumping around too, but there's going to be different paths available to you, new opportunities, something new, a vacation, a trip, something new in your life coming along. And think about the deer when you're choosing your paths. Anytime you start a new venture, go a different direction, the deer is usually there to guide you along, okay?
Okay.
So think about him, and I'll pull one more quickly here. Next, let me see what we get here. Oh, this is the chameleon. And the chameleon is telling me that sometimes you have to have a little bit more patience. Are we hitting this on the nail?
Yeah. I think that was for my husband.
Yeah, sure. Okay. But you know how they sit on the trees and the branches, and they actually will change colors when different things come their way. So you just have to have patience and sit there and relax a little bit at times. It's funny because the rest of the cards were talking about movement, and then we get this card, and it's talking about having patience. Maybe when your husband starts jumping around, you got to have a little bit more patience with him.
That might
okay.
be. Okay.
All right. There we go. Thank you so much. I wish I could spend more time. We would keep going with that one. Thank you.
You take it easy.
You too.
Awesome. That's a new listener. And
great.
And so there we go. There we go, loop-de-loop.
And I'm mixing the cards as you're getting your next step.
Hey, Sherry.
Sherry.
Hi, Sherry.
Hi there.
How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Sherry, I already mixed them up 100 times for you. So
cool.
Good. Well, talking there. Let's see what we get. We got the fox, first of all. And this fox is telling me that right now you should be a little bit more adaptable. That he's very adaptable to different situations. There's going to be different things happening with you and things changing in your life, too, sort of like that hopping around a little bit. But this is more, I think, closer to home. You just have to adapt to things that are going on around you, your environment. We all run into these situations where we're trying to do one thing, trying to do our thing, but just think there's different ways to do it. Okay? Be a little bit more adaptable on how you're trying to do things. Okay? Let me pull another one for you. Uh-oh. This is the ancient croc.
Well, I am ancient.
The croc that. No, you're not. But anyway. Um, he's talking a little bit about taking care of business and not to worry so much about what you have to do. Things will take care of themselves. I think they're going together a little bit. The fox was talking about being adaptable, of course, but the croc is talking more about, I think, your spiritual awareness, because he's so old and ancient in them swamps, and he just wants to also try to control his environment, but it's changing on him. The swamps are getting, you know, sometimes polluted, sometimes wiped out, and other times they're flooding so much that there's no land for him to go on, you know, things like that. That's why he's trying to get into people's swimming pools. You know, he has a problem with that. But the thing about him is he's a survivor. And whatever happens, you'll know that you can survive, okay?
Okay.
There's different energies with him, too. Well, you got another amphibian. You got the frog, too. And the frog probably is going along with the crocodile. The frog is about your environment. And frogs, and no matter how messy that swamp might look like, they don't like toxicity. They don't like chemicals and things around them. So just remember that. You've got to take care of what's around you and maybe clean up little things here or there, okay?
Okay.
Now, one more. Are you a leader by any chance? Are you a leader in any kind of club, organization, work?
In my mind, I want to lead everybody.
Okay, well, that's you. You're the lady tiger that I just got. Because the tigers are definitely leaders, all them big cats. It's usually the women that get these big cats. And you know, I had a cougar as my animal of the day the other day.
I'm sure you did.
I did. Yeah, look at my Facebook page. I had a lot of comments on it. Not from the people who I thought were cougars, though. But but this is a big cat. And this cat, tigers are all about leading. They're usually given to people who are in control, who have, you know, management people, who might be people leading the Cub Scout pack, let's say, you know, things like that. Anything, church organization. But they're leaders. You know, if you're in school, you'd be president of the class. So just remember that. That's leadership for you, okay?
Okay.
Did I get three or four? I got four for you. That's good. Anybody else, Chris?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you, Sherry.
Take it easy. And I'm pretty sure anyway. So now I'm going to say, Kathleen, if you, I saw you there, Kathleen, if you want to press one on your phone. If you want to get a reading.
A quick one, yeah. Oh, we got time. We got about
we got about
18 minutes. Yeah.
Kathleen, okay.
Let's see how it's Russian people.
Kathleen, are you there?
Yeah.
Are you?
Hello.
Are you listening? Hey, are you, or did you want to get some cards pulled?
Well, if there's nobody else, yeah, I'll do it. I was just listening. I was fascinated and enjoying just listening in. So.
We'll go with that. Anybody else, let me know. Let me know in the chat room. Hey, go ahead,
okay.
Stan.
Kathleen, your birth date for your month, please.
The month? January 3rd.
3rd? Oh, that's easy. 1, 2, 3. Yay. Okay, let's see what we got. First card I got for you, Kathleen, is the wild boar. And he's saying that there's times you got to really dig in, that somebody or something might be bothering you right now, and at times you got to dig in there. You know how they dig in, root into the mud and the dirt and get a little deeper in things? Sometimes you got to stand your ground, and somebody might try to persuade you or lead you in their direction right now, but don't do it. You should just stand your ground and be your own person, okay?
Okay.
Let's see what we get. No, this is these are new cards to me, like I said, Chris, and I'm just reading them for the first time. This is the llama.
Ooh.
Llama drama. Llama drama.
Llama drama.
I don't need no llama drama.
Well, actually, he's telling me about being, their own person to stand tall. I'm seeing the picture, and this llama has got its head up and standing very tall. So it's basically the same thing as the wild boar, except the boar was digging into the ground, but this llama, the presentation of it on the card is very much showing me the same kind of picture, that, you know, being strong, being tough, and standing your own ground, and that's what the llama's doing. So just think of it that way, and I'll get one or two more for you. Okay. That's a parrot. That's a beautiful parrot. I never... Okay. The parrot is talking to me. He's sitting on my shoulder and talking to me. And I do see parrots around people a lot of time when I do readings in person. I see animals around people. The parrot is sitting on my shoulder and he's squawking in my ear. She's not getting enough sunshine. She's not getting enough sunshine. Could that be true?
Yes, but I have skin cancer. So I don't want to get any sunshine.
Right. Well, okay. But that's all right. But he was right on, though, in a way that you might be able to, you know, get sunshine in a different way. But there's a reason.
I get out. I wear plenty of sunshine. I will not let my vitamin D levels go too low, for sure. That's funny.
Okay. Right, that he came up, and he was screaming about sunshine in my ear here. So that's the connection with you. But there's sunshine can come to you in different ways. There's things you can do to bring sunshine into your life, even if you can't enjoy the bright sun all the time. I have to watch, too. I don't get out in the sun as much as I used to. But... he's saying that you've got to get more sunshine into your life in other ways. Whether you enjoy doing things, you might enjoy going to movies, you might enjoy any kind of sporting events or some kind of activity. There's things you could do to bring sunshine into your life without having to go lay on the beach. And I think that's what he's talking about. So try and get some of that into your life, okay?
Okay, I sure will.
And let me get one more for you, since we do have time. Okay, this is the cobra. Huh. And once again, the snakes are all about skin. See, these two are connected somehow, the sunshine and the snakes. And the snakes are healers, believe it or not. All snakes are healers. And they do shed their skin. So... if you shed that skin and do things, there's a new life waiting for you. So you might not have to go into the bright sunshine to get it, but you still need this sunshine coming into your soul, into your body, even though it's not might be the regular sun. So there's going to be something new. You're shedding the old ways and starting the new ways with you. So think about it that way, okay?
All right. Sounds exciting.
Very good.
Well,
yeah,
thank you.
New things.
You're here tomorrow, Kathleen?
Yes.
Yeah. Good. Good answer.
you hope you show up, huh?
We didn't miss it. I've only missed one.
Yeah, no, you've been solid. Solid.
Well, when you come once a year, you don't have to worry about that.
Yeah. Stan's been solid, too. You know, Stan's never let me down.
Never. I've always come when I'm supposed to.
Yeah. Either time.
Go on.
I'm just kidding. Okay, I'm going to mute Kathleen now. Heath, can you hear me? Heath, Earth calling you. He listens every night faithfully, but from work, and he can't ever call in.
Okay, Heath, we'll pull some cards for him.
Just getting his attention. Yeah, what's your number? What's the day of your birth, not the month? Day. 19th, of course.
The same as mine.
Eight. See, 1 and 9 is 10, and then reduce that to 1.
Okay, 19. Well, I only got about 19 cards left here. He's got to go out and have a little bit more fun in his life. He's got the dolphin here, and the dolphin tells him to do some deep breathing. First of all, you go breathe, breathe, breathe. That's what the dolphin does, and he wants you to enjoy life a little bit more. You got to get out there and really do some fun things, even if you have to do them by yourself or with the group, whatever. I enjoy going to movies by myself. You know, I don't care who wants to go or if anybody goes, but I go to all kind of movies. And that's one of the fun things I do by myself normally. But you could do whatever you want. You could do with people or not people, you know, but have some fun. Your vacation was canceled because of work. Oh, Heath. Well, book another vacation. Book another vacation. You can, well, have fun at work. I don't know.
He does have fun at work. He listens to Curious Times.
Yes. Yeah, this is a Curious Times. Okay. Well, I got the moose for you, too, Heath. And this moose, once again, these big, strong animals are coming through. But he's talking about a couple things to me. He's talking about you're going to be overcoming some adversity in your life. That this might be the problem with canceling vacation. That was adversity. But you're going to overcome it. You're going to stand tall like all the big, the elk, the moose. They all stand tall like that. And be strong. You can't let up. You can't let others get you down. You got to always be strong in your faith and what you want to do for yourself, okay? Let's see. And another one? Uh-oh. This is going to talk about a big, strong guy. This is the rhinoceros. Rhinoceros. Okay. He's saying that he's making his own path. And he's saying that the path you're on may not be your own. It's probably forced upon you for some reasons. And it might not be by your own choosing. So just remember to try and develop your own path and do a little bit more of what you want to do. I think this has to do with all three cards, actually. So think about that a second. Find your own path. Do more what you want to do. I know everybody has situations that we can't always do that. But just try to find your own path, okay? That's what the big guy is saying. Got a little bird sitting on his back, too. It looks like that crow. Anyway, we got one more for you, Keith. Heath. Yes, I'm sorry. It's the mountain goat. And this guy is all about us, okay? And what he wants is balancing both your spiritual side and your physical side. Some people really, really get into the spiritual stuff. You know, they get into the mediumship. They get into readings. They get into church. They get into all this spiritual stuff in their life. And they let their lives be ruled by the spiritual stuff. Other people get into the physical side of things, you know. They're always worried about, like you said, their work, money, where's everything going to come from? That's more of the physical side of life. Both of them are great, but they have to balance each other out. Once you start doing too much of one and not enough of the other, you get out of kilter. I love to watch them mountain goats. There's a lot of them out around Mount Rushmore.
Mount Rushmore. That's funny.
Mount Rushmore area. There's a lot of them out there, and I love to look at them. I got some beautiful pictures of them last time.
Ow?
Yeah. So, yeah, that's a good one. I'll really get balanced with that. Give me another drink, Chris.
But see, I should have said.
It's only water. It's only water.
But it's good water, man.
It's good water. It's spring water. Thank you.
Listen, you guys, I want to quickly do, because Tiffany's here. And yeah. Tiffany gave us a song that she did, and I just got it. I just got it by email. I haven't even had a chance to hear it yet, and since she's here, and everybody mostly, most everybody knows Tiffany now, and so it's called Whiskey Bent, and so we're going to hear this thing for the first time at Curious Times, and so... So now, on your Skype call, Stan, click on the little microphone, the little blue microphone thing there, and mute yourself that way, and then I'll do the same on my mic, so that hopefully we'll just get good song, no static, no nothing, and so here we go, you guys. I guess I can't mute myself then, so we'll start it over.
The days go by, some bad word. You took a part of me when you left. Another night seems like eternity. To know you left me here and good angel wings. I don't see any writing in the sky, even though I am baptized. But you know that ain't me anyway. You always were the hard-headed one. Because I had to go, it don't mean I'm gone. And now I'm heaven bound.
get a seagull across my crown. We will wish you a day. But I'm your angel now. About your sister here. Like now she's whistling, you know. You have great strength too, you know, that you can sing an emotional thing like that, and I'd be bawling my eyes out. I wouldn't be able to even speak. You know what I mean? I remember too watching that video of you. You were performing, and it was right after you lost your sister, and I couldn't believe the amazing grace and strength that you had. So you have great beauty as well, and dang, you have an awesome voice. So I think you should go on one of those shows, because you got the great story that goes with it too. You know what I mean? And so thank you so much for sharing that song with us. And I'm sorry for the people that it broke up for. It sounded okay on my end, but it always does. And Stan, are you there? You can unmute now. Stan, the man. Stan. Are you still on my Skype call?
Yeah, I'm here. I pulled another card for Tiffany, too, if you want to hear it.
Yeah, let's hear it.
I got Scorpion for you, and Scorpion is talking, like I said, this is a brand new deck. This Scorpion is talking about relationships and about the challenges that they offer, and that the part of it is ecstasy and part of it is pain. So I just heard you mention about your sister, so it might be, you know, the pain of that and the ecstasy of performing the song. Maybe you could do it in her honor, you know, so that would be great.
Her sister was a state trooper, and
mm-hmm.
she like died in a boating accident.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
That
happens, yeah.
And so,
so sorry to hear that.
Yeah, so that's how we met Tiffany, actually.
Oh, she didn't hear it? I saw what the peacock card was.
Oh, say the peacock card again.
Okay. The peacock, I can't even talk today. The peacock card is talking about relationships, and this might be the relationship between you and your sister. And what it's talking about is the part of the relationship was ecstasy, and part of it was pain. Of course, losing her was the pain, and now you got the ecstasy, and maybe the song can go in her honor, you know? So there you go.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Well, Stan, you made
yes.
it through 2 hours.
Yeah, I know. I mean, just looking through this new deck here yet, see if I can pick a card out of here by looking them all and
mm-hmm.
find one for you.
Oh, okay.
And we got the bat.
Of course you did, Stan. Thank you.
Right here. You want to see it? It's a bat.
Stan.
And this bat is telling me that you have the power to transcend failure and move into a limitless future. Mm-hmm. See, and you were laughing at the bat. Plus, you like to work at night. So there you go.
I would make a great vampire, I guess you would.
Bats are very, very good for everybody, though. Everybody
yeah.
should take care of the bats.
We do need bats.
Yes.
Bats and bees.
Yep, I see bees in this deck, too. Bees are about forgiveness. Mm. There's butterflies, there's crabs, panda bear, there's a rabbit.
Rabbit.
Scarab beetle, bears, porcupines. We mentioned porcupines earlier in the show.
Mm-hmm.
Other big cats. So there's a lot of neat cards in there.
How is it like 78 cards? How many?
This one's 50-some, I think.
52, I bet.
52.
Mm, see?
Yeah, very good. it's kind of a neat deck.
Awesome. That's awesome. And so it's been really good. Like, don't be such a stranger, you know what I mean? People enjoy that kind of a show, eh?
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Next time we bring your camera, like, even if you use the camera just to show the cards, you know what I mean? You can wear a bag over your face. You know.
Well, actually, you know, I tried a camera and there was a big light around me, like I had a halo. I don't know what that was. It was like I had, you know, if you see them pictures in church with the round ring around their head, you know.
Happens when I do that.
Yeah, that's like it was. Only this was the whole light. It was reflecting. It was brighter than that, though, Chris.
Of course your light would be brighter, Stan.
Well, yeah, of course my light would be brighter.
Light is much
I've been around longer, so I've been around forever.
You were around like in headlights.
You were reading about, I don't know, we in that overtime mode now?
Yeah, we're in overtime, you guys.
You were talking about Blog Talk, and I was on Blog Talk, like Kathy and I were on Blog Talk a long, long time before you got there, you know, so... I'm so sad when she passed away too, you know. But we were in, we both had shows on, and that was a long time ago.
Astrid came to listen for a while to you.
Oh, great. I haven't talked to her in forever.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. She dashed out when the reading started, it looked like that. So I didn't...
Oh, when I quit talking? Oh, that's because I didn't say anything about her. Yes, sir. I'm supposed to be psychic. I'm supposed to know. Hey, there's Astrid.
Uh-huh.
I haven't. No, I used to talk to her once in a while. I haven't talked to her for a long time.
She
ever since she went on
forever,
that,
so I'm sure
that book tour or whatever she took. You know, I haven't talked to her. Yeah. She went on that book thing, right?
Yeah, last I don't know if she's moved back home now or not. She had moved out to Vegas, and I don't know if she was last
wow.
time. She was maybe going to move back home. Back to the... Ponderosa.
She still has one of my hawks. I lent her a hawk when she went to Europe there a couple of years ago, and I just this hawk's going with you over there. And she took the hawk, and she still has it. What do you think of that? She hawked my hawk. Like, maybe
hawk,
she hawked in Vegas.
She hawked it. She hawked it. And she let it ride on number 14.
Yeah, and probably in Vegas somewhere there.
She lost
probably
her hawk.
Probably some showgirl got my hawk now.
Somebody's outfit is now your hawk, you know.
Oh, God. They took the feathers, you know.
Yeah, they did.
Oh, the poor thing.
And so you guys feel free to unmute yourselves, those of you guys that are in there on overtime. So I'm going to, at risk of, you know, another song breaking up, I do love this song, and so I'm going to play it and give people a chance to get themselves hooked up for overtime. And it's the Arval Bird Animal Totem song. And here we go.
The great Cherokee said, we must all learn to walk in balance and harmony with everything. If you let the animals know that you mean good, they will be good to you. They will be our helpers. Chief Eagle, the Lakota holy man. So the Creator has given us nature to use and preserve, and it is only through nature that we can truly commune with the great mystery. His people believe that the Creator had breathed the same breath into all living things, creating all things sacred, and that everything in nature spoke. If we people would but listen, if you were to sit quietly in nature long enough, you would find the answers to the questions for which your heart is hungry. Our indigenous ancestors believed we were not put here on the land to be parasites and live off of it, but to live in the land and the land in us, or we don't survive. And for those that believe this way, that is how we worship the Creator. That is the only worship of God there is.
Love that. All right, so there we go. We're back, and
that's great. That's great.
So, is anyone unmuting themselves, or what are we going to do, you guys? Get out of here, Deb, Mary Margaret, Kathleen, Eric. Anybody? Here comes Deb with her camera. Hi, Deb.
How is everyone?
Pretty good. She has this beautiful deep voice, you know. Her and
Jen.
It sounds.
Jen.
Yeah, but Deb's is a little bit like English, you know.
Yeah,
say that.
She has that air about her.
Yeah.
You mean British like?
Yes.
Oh. Funny.
Like, hey, baby. Like,
Oh, God. What the
Guess
hell
the
is that?
One.
Got a new cat. Which one's this one?
That's Autumn. She's the one that...
Beautiful.
Yeah, she's a pretty... She's a Maine Coon.
Yeah.
I don't want to mess with them. I'm going to quickly, because I just about said the F-bomb, but...
Sure,
she's beautiful. How old is she? About 13 or 7?
13, yeah, they're both 13.
How effing good am I? Okay, I'm going to end the archive part of the show. Thanks, archive listeners. Back tomorrow with Kathleen Moore, and we'll have more for you tomorrow. Tomorrow. We'll have more for you tomorrow. Okay.